Caucus.
So hello everybody. We're having a little bit different type of a show today. We had some technical difficulties and we are waiting on the parts, so we won't be having our normal show as usual with Uphill Media, but we're streaming this to at least get what we have to say today out. So that we can inform the great people of this state of what we have going on. I know Supreet has a few updates that she's going to be giving us. She found some stuff on Adam Smith and she wants to promote Sarah. We all want to promote Sarah.
Yep.
And
there's a reason why we want to promote Sarah. This is one glaring example. I was going through his FEC filings and on July 31st, 2017, last year, he paid membership dues for Council on Foreign Relations. So I started digging into them and turns out, they are a think tank. And this is, I found an article by Counterpunch that talks about CFR, that is Council on Foreign Relations. And this is what they say. To be clear, the CFR's ideal powerful state is a capitalist, neoliberal, and imperial. It is one in which what the left sociologist Pierre Bourdieu called the right hand of the state, the parts of the government that work to redistribute wealth and power yet further upwards, that means towards the rich, fight wars and discipline the working class and lower class majority, that right hand, is far more potent and well-funded than the left hand of the state, the parts of the government won by past popular movements like the labor movement that protect and advance the interest of workers, the poor, and the common good. The CFR's recent and deceptively named Renewing America Initiative for Restoring U.S. Global Power at Home advocates federal debt reduction, not through progressive taxation or cutting back the giant Pentagon budget, but through major rollbacks of so-called entitlements like Social Security and Medicare. It calls for tying immigration policy more directly to the market needs of corporations. That means that please bring in people who corporations can use and exploit for their labor. That explains Donald Trump's immigration policy so well, because he's like, why do we need to get people from Haiti and Africa? Those people are not who we need. We need a well-educated populace because we have let our education and infrastructure fall apart. So we need other countries who have their shit together, to send their people here and make our rich people even richer. And while they're here, they won't get healthcare, they won't have a good infrastructure, they won't have education, quality education for their kids, and they have no retirement, no pensions. And this is their ideal America. And Adam Smith is a member of this council. Shows where his loyalties lie.
I would say that that's complete and utter bullshit, and I'm not gonna apologize for that at all, because that's garbage. I mean, to be able to bring people over here for that is why? Yeah. What's the point? What's the purpose for greed?
And I'd say there, with considering all of that, I don't think there's any way in that he can describe himself as progressive. There's has he claimed progressive?
He has.
Yeah, That's what I thought.
So he was a moderate Democrat, but his district got redistricted and he got some of the poor people and the people of color. So now he started saying, I'm a progressive Democrat who's practical. He almost lost his seat when his district was redistricted to include more people of color. So I think the only reason why he keeps winning is because there is not a viable candidate. And the only reason DCCC is pushing him is because I can show you in his donations, he has given lots of money to DCCC, $75,000 just in the last year. And this is only till September of last year. Since then, I don't know how much more he's donated. And
from that September is why DCCC 30th. So that's not even the beginning of September. That's from basically October 1st through January 1st.
Yep.
Like just October, November, and December.
No, this is January 2017 to September 30, 2017.
Oh, okay. Yeah. I'm sorry. So January after through, that. Okay, the first 9 months.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yep, first 9 months of last year. So we don't have the last quarter of the year and what's happened this month so far.
Okay.
I am sure he's given the 250,000 donation that DCCC requires. before they support a candidate. And that's why they are trying to elbow out Sarah.
Absolutely.
Yep. And this also says that CFR is a privatization advocate. Doesn't have to work another day in his life if he doesn't. So I strongly encourage people read this article. It's by Counterpunch. The title is Yes, There is an Imperialist Ruling Class.
Wow. Can we make a link to that?
Yep.
That we can make sure we're making a list of links to anything we're referencing.
Got it.
And then, Brian, where do you suggest those links go? Into YouTube or?
Right now, you can throw them in the chat. And then at the end of the show, I usually save all of the chat onto the computer. So
makes sense.
Yeah.
Okay. Anything else you guys would like to talk about today? We have our platform meeting coming. Do we want to inform people about that?
Well, wait. I feel like I have something to tell you in a similar vein about Representative Derek Kilmer.
Oh.
And so I put together a little something about a month or two ago. All the links are listed. Some of them are Wikipedia. Well, I think most of them are Wikipedia, then with more links there. So it's all very surface information. Like, didn't go too deep. But Derek Kilmer, U.S. representative from CD6 in Washington, is a former business consultant for McKinsey & Company. So then I looked at McKinsey & Company, and it's a worldwide management consulting firm. Is there another, is that a think tank kind of thing? A management consulting firm?
No, management consulting are those consultants who help with
qualitative and quantitative analysis.
Yeah, that would be just campaign data. So I am a consultant. That's how I gave into the capitalist system. Okay. But so what we do is if you have to make a decision, like campaigns make decisions on time to time, you look at the past data, how your product or in campaign's case, who is your voters who are most likely to come, what are the messaging they'd like to hear, and sort of allow you to skirt a line while still getting the minimum amount of people to vote for you that is needed to win.
Okay. So it said they provided these management in order to evaluate management decisions across public and private sectors, or I think to stress the public. So they help create public policy. It's culture has often been compared to religion because of the influence, loyalty, and zeal of its members.
Are you talking about Ernst & Young?
No, McKinsey & Company.
Oh, very same thing. I know these people. Yeah.
Okay.
Very true.
And Fortune magazine said partners talk to each other with a sense of personal affection and admiration.
It's called good service. People can't pretend how to smile and behave.
Okay. An article in the News Observer said McKinsey's internal culture was collegiate and ruthlessly competitive and has been described as arrogant.
Yep. It's mostly white men too in these big consulting firms.
Right.
Mods of white men.
So there's some more descriptions, but that part doesn't matter as much as that the company has been influential in the British Department of Health for many years and was heavily involved in the discussions around the Health and Social Care Act of 2012.
Oh gosh.
So writing in the BMJ, British Medical Journal, Clive Peedle, co-chair of the National Health System Consultants Association and a consultant clinical oncologist, compared the policies put forth by McKinsey with academic analysis of privatization and found evidence that privatization is an inevitable consequence of many of the policies contained in the health and social care bill. So they promoted policy that would lead to the privatization of the national healthcare system in Great Britain.
It's the same thing that Republicans do here. It is their governing policy. They'll tell you government does not work, government does not, nobody can get anything done. And mm-hmm. they run on that. Then they stop every bill that does anything to help the working class and stop anything to help the working class. They don't want to do. And they use that as an example and then they point back to it and say, see, I told you the government doesn't work. And it's the same thing. They gut Medicare and Social Security to the point where it cannot provide services well enough. And then they point to that and say, see, we told you privatization is the only answer.
So, and these people have D's behind their name.
Yeah.
And we have two of them in Washington. Six? I mean, two minimum. Mm-hmm. Let's start Googling the other ones now.
Yeah.
Six and nine. So heck nine. And ten. What the heck? So I do want to touch on why we're having a slightly different format today. What's going on? Yeah. What's different?
Absolutely.
Our production company?
Producer, John Ellis.
Yeah, our producer, John Ellis. He is Uphill Media, which was formerly Bernie 2016 TV and Political Revolution TV. He experienced an equipment malfunction and he was able to still live stream the Bernie Sanders Medicare for All event. And during that time, he was able to raise enough funds through engagement broadcasting, which is what we're doing under his guidance. He was able to raise $1,300 in 24 hours and that is going to pay for what he needs, but he won't have it for a few more days. So that's why we're just scrapping it out here.
The point is that they use servers and the Uphill Media channel has grown very fast in the past few months. Progressive Washington, Progressive California both started their shows and they have more and more requests for We the People, more and more candidates want to come in. And all of the cameras, except for mine, all of the cameras that people on regular shows use are of high quality. Their voice is of high quality. To make sure that the quality remains high, you need high processing power. That's what they use those in-house servers for. The computer, laptop itself does not have as much power. It will compress image quality and voice quality. And that is why he had that server. That server malfunctioned. And because of the Bernie Town Hall, he did raise some money, but that's just one time. It's not just about Bernie. It's about all of us. We have candidates here in Washington that we'd like to promote. There's candidates and issues in California. They've been talking about Medicare. Washington and California are now basically in a race to see who's going to be the first state to have Medicare for all.
Come on, and Washington.
We want to have that show for everybody. We want to tell you about the awesome candidates that are running without corporate money, and they have a real chance. Let's throw these imperialist corporate Democrats out. But to do that, when mainstream media won't cover it, we need grassroots journalism. And by doing engagement broadcasting like John does and like these people do, you have, you, the viewers, have a chance to directly interact with these candidates. Your questions are not parsed through layers. There's no inherent bias because there is no filter. You ask the questions on YouTube and they get asked. So, To allow us to keep doing this in the same transparent manner, we need your support. It only takes $27 a show to keep it running.
Yes.
28?
I have some of the information here.
Yeah.
There is getting there.
It's okay. We have almost 400 views on each of our shows in Progressive Washington.
I'm sorry?
We have almost 400 views on an average on Progressive Washington shows. So everybody needs to donate way less than a dollar to—
Absolutely. Much of that we got directly from Uphill Media. So we also have to share this out to your Washington peeps. Mm-hmm. Share. because we need Washingtonians to be supporting the Washington show. And Uphill Media needs $500 in a month in recurring
donations.
And right now we're at 137. He does have a Patreon that gets about $200 a month that he's going to be closing. And so and he's hoping that everybody from that account will switch over. So best case scenario, he's at $337 a month for his recurring donations. Mm-hmm. That so we need $163 a month away from the goal.
Yeah.
And if each show he did, and he produces six shows a week right now, if each show he did made $27 a show.
The Bernie number.
The Bernie number. It would cover everything. So it literally is, I think, $26 and change for him. I'm sorry?
I said that number keeps repeating itself. Maybe it's the universe giving us a sign.
I know.
Sanders 2020, he's running. Yes. Oh my God, let's talk about that now.
Oh, wait. No, I want to do more justice for Uphill Media. And then we'll keep going. And we're going to do this uphill. We are doing the broadcast. We're doing public support here, people. This is a fundraiser.
Even if all of you donate $1 every show, it'll go a long way, but try to donate more if you can.
That's right. And he said that if you have $50 to donate once, he would rather have you have a regular $4 recurring monthly donation. So that's about $50 a year. Yeah. So he'll take single one-time donations, but when he knows there's a recurring thing, a recurring payment coming, he knows what he can rely on.
Yeah.
And we can schedule our budget accordingly too, because we've been running into, the thing is we need backup equipment as well. So it's not just that we're not trying to make money. We have to maintain our equipment. And if something breaks down, we won't have to shut the show down to be able to repair it. So that would be a great thing to have.
Which is essential going into 2018. We need to be able to rely on our equipment, because the ground game is going to start. By the end of this month, all campaigns are going to be in full swing.
Yes. And then we also, there's a way to donate to Uphill Media by donating through Progressive Washington, so that they know that your donation is coming from a Progressive Washington motivation. So then once he gets his needs met to cover our show, anything after that then gets used by us for equipment and as we see fit.
Yep. If we can have the equipment here, we can do our own live streams, and that would give us ability to do more frequent shows. So any way you can help, please help keep Engagement Broadcasting alive.
Yes.
Thank you very much for that.
Sorry, I had a little off-camera chat here. So Brian, is there a way for you to pull up and screen share somehow the link for?
I'm putting the link for our Action Network in the chat right now for YouTube. So if you want to donate or have the ability to donate through Uphill, I put that link up there and you'll be able to follow that. I can also put it in the description later on after this live stream gets concluded. So please stay tuned if you would like to contribute.
Excellent. Thank you, Brian. Because I have yet to seek out and find that information, so I would not be the most efficient. So we would like to have $27 a week in recurring
donations
on behalf of Progressive Washington, because that's the cost of our show.
That's right there is to maintain our current level of what we're doing.
Yeah. And then, but Supreet, you were, part of an event recently on houselessness and homelessness.
Oh, yes. On housing and homelessness. So Our Revolution King County and Our Revolution Washington Bernicrats Coalition now had a town hall on housing and homelessness. And for that, we owed Uphill Media was our live stream partner, which is why the live stream looked so professionally done. Ash, one of the producers came up, or maybe he's not the producer, but he worked with the equipment. He's our tech guy. He came down here and trained somebody in Washington to do it, but also ran the event that day. So he was here for a day and a half. And this is how he makes his money. He has a family. And our bill to Uphill Media from Uphill Media was $1,500. And out of that, which included personnel fees and very low, reasonable charge for camera rent and equipment renting, we are $1,090 short of that. So you can go and watch that video, that town hall on Uphill Media, their YouTube channel. If you like that, please, please, please donate. We'll be able to put more events like that if we know that Uphill Media can rely on us paying their fees.
That's right.
And we actually have a platform building event coming up. Like we are building a progressive leftist platform for the state of Washington. And we wanted to culminate in a progressive Washington People's Progressive Summit on February 24th. So we would like to ask Uphill Media again for our help, but I want to make sure that we can actually pay them what they're owed if we use their services. And if we don't have Uphill Media, the sound quality is very low. The video quality is not good without paying egregious amount of fees. So please help us keep doing this, help us keep putting together events and bringing progressives together, connecting candidates to the general progressive voters so they can also get help in their campaigns. All of this helps get that end goal of having a more just future. I know it's very hard to reach into your pockets, so do not worry if it's not like $5, $10. If you can even contribute a little, that is appreciated. And links for that would also be, for donating for the town hall, will also be in the description later. And I'll send it to Brian so he can post it in the chat right now.
Right, so we're going to have some guests on. We've got our very own Mr. Oz here. Mm-hmm. Oh, he's rejoining. He'll be back in a second. There we go.
Good day, mates. How's it going?
How's it going, Oz? Looking good there, buddy.
Are we ready for the Land of Oz this Friday yet?
I don't think we're ready for this, but let's go.
I need 1 minute.
You need 1 minute, huh? Anyway, welcome to the Land of Oz, and it's great to see you all, because I got to say, everybody out there, there's no nobler people than these people here. They'd make Lancelot himself blush. So today, we want to talk about how the progressives are getting stomped on in their quest to join campaigns and bring the progressive movement forward. I'd like to share some screens here, and we've got a little video, and then we're gonna have our very own Supreme Carr talk about the video. And she's gonna give us some insights on Sarah Smith's campaign against Adam Smith, not only Adam Smith, but the entire Washington State Democratic Party, mind you. Anyway, we're gonna start out, as you can see, the theme of the Land of Oz this week is going to be the pirate theme, because I've decided to become a pirate, because it's time to step up to the plate and do some good. So I've got the good ship Oz here, and we're going to show you on my screen share. I hope you can see it. Can you see the good ship Oz, everybody?
We can.
You can. Well, that's the good ship Oz. Well, it's not as good as it is committed. I'll tell you that much. Then we're gonna talk about the progressive warrior Pirate Oz himself. That's all done, we've talked about it. We're gonna move on to Adam Smith's party boat of BS. You know Adam Smith, He's part of the establishment Democrat. He's a corporate Democrat, and he's in a battle right now with Sarah Smith, the progressive candidate, the real progressive candidate for Washington's 9th District. We want to get behind Sarah Smith, so we are putting together a battleship for Sarah Smith to go up against Adam Smith's party boat of BS. So we've decided to pull this one out of the mothballs and go after Adam Smith. I think we've got a good advantage against his neoliberal party boat. What do you all think about that?
I love it. Yarr.
It looks powerful.
Well, I just want to say that Adam Smith, along with Derek Kilmer and Denny Heck and the rest of them, they're all corporate-owned Democrats, corporate Democrats, and I've got... to say they're all cash cows for the Washington State Democratic Party. As you can see here, Adam Smith is a cash cow. So's Denny Heck, so's Kilmer, so's Larson, Delbeny, and the rest. Of course they're not going to want a progressive candidate to run against them because they're the big cash flow. Adam Smith donated in the 2016 election cycle about $250,000 to the Washington State and the DCCC to make sure that he got the advantage in election in the up-and-coming progressive battle. As we see there, he also donated a handsome sum to the 30th District Democrats. So it's called trickle-down cash-cowing around. Now, let's get to the real meat of the matter, mateys. What we have is one of the best progressives I've seen in decades. Sarah Smith for Congress is running against the corporate-owned Adam Smith. With that, I would like to go to this wonderful, wonderful presentation on Sarah Smith. And if you don't hear your progressive candidates talking like this, they don't deserve your vote. After this, I'm going to let Supreet Kaur talk about this video and how they put it together and what they hope to gain. I'm going to hand it over to our producer, Brian, and he's going to kick this off. It's about 6 minutes long, and it's worth every second.
Yeah. Let me get it up for you guys. Keep with the theme. Uh-oh.
Hi, my name is Sarah Smith. I'm running for Congress in Washington State's 9th District.
So I worked for Citigroup right when in 2009 through 2010, so right when a lot of people were coming out and declaring bankruptcy and they couldn't stay in their homes and trying to find foreclosure assistance. So I worked pretty much at the height of foreclosure in America. I met a lot of people and spoke to a lot of people who were just good, hardworking individuals who wanted to just keep a roof over their head and who wound up in a bad situation that wasn't their fault. And I think that we let big banks gamble and lose enough with our fortunes, enough with our savings, with our college funds. We let them gamble enough. They already showed they can't be trusted to make positive decisions for people by trading all the bad mortgages they were trading. A particular story that comes to mind is I actually was working on helping this woman. She's a single mother of three, and she was a nurse, and she was working. She had just gotten back into the working world after her divorce from her husband. She told me her whole life story, and her mortgage payment became too much for her to bear. She lost her job, even as a nurse. She was unemployed, and she didn't know what to do. She had three kids. She was the sole income provider, and to me, she was scraping by doing some side work and things like that, but she wasn't taking home a real salary. And I was hit really hard by her circumstance. And when I plugged everything into the tool we were using, it kept denying her for this repayment plan, but I knew she met the parameters. So we're not supposed to do this at the time, but I told her I would give her a call back. And so I disconnected my phone. I actually ended up calling directly to the Fannie Mae representative that coordinated with Citigroup at the time. And I had the representative actually come out to our site and put her information in and do a manual override because he agreed with me. He didn't know what was going on, but the tool errored out and she should have qualified and never did. So he was actually able to override it and get her to the program, and they let me call her back and be the one to tell her. And I remember it was like a 3-day process, and she said she started to cry on the phone about how she was waiting with bated breath and how she was just so grateful that someone actually went the extra mile. And it hit me so hard that I tried to make sure for the rest of my working life I'm always going the extra mile, because I never know what person I'm going to interact with next that's going to get hit hard by something and need someone just to care a little bit more. And that's really important to me as a person. It's important to me in how I work. It's important in how I approach the world. But that's how I want to approach this kind of legislation, is how is this going to affect the nurse with three kids who's a single mom? How is this going to affect those working people in the end? And then I took a break from that because I realized I wasn't happy in those fields and I needed to do something better. And I wanted to do better. I wanted to do something that had a positive and meaningful impact on people. So I took a job at a small business. I love helping out a local business owner. I love being a part of that environment. And then the opportunity arose to run for Congress. And I figured what better way to help people than to, you know, the ultimate ask, right?
I've always been politically active. I come from a very political family. Got lots of cool stories about my dad. He actually helped pen the legislation that brought a single-payer healthcare to Ireland. And I've always done voter drives. I helped participate in anti-war activism during high school after the Iraq War started. I've been pretty involved with volunteer work through Planned Parenthood, through the Humane Society. We organized food drives for my old company, and I was on their volunteer board and everything like that. So I've got a lot of volunteer experience and a lot of legal experience.
So we talk about things like Medicare for All and Universal College and things like that. And the question everyone always talks about is, oh, well, there's no money for that. Let me tell you, 60% of that $1 billion budget goes to private contracting companies off of our taxpayer dollars. So we're sending mercenaries out because we're involved in so many goddamn wars. And when they finally hammered out the budget, it was actually closer to $800 billion. And Adam Smith said, this is a good budget. No, it's not. If that doesn't include universal single-payer Medicare for all the people, debt-free education, revitalization of our infrastructure, expanding grant programs so we have municipal internet and be done with this net neutrality garbage, that's not a good budget. I don't care what else is in it. It is not a good budget if it does nothing for the people. And I am so sick and tired of this argument about not having enough money.
Adam Smith is a 21-year sitting incumbent that has done pretty much nothing. He's never fought for progressive values. He's been a self-described moderate. He's voted in favor of every bad trade deal except for CAFTA. He's a war hawk. He's very comfortable with the war industry. He takes thousands of their dollars, and he talks about, oh, we need to increase troop salaries, but he doesn't talk about cutting the 60% of that military budget that goes towards private contractors, who are conveniently also the companies who donate to his campaign. He votes in favor of increasing the military budget, and then he talks about how he voted against one of the Appropriations Acts. And he says, well, where are we going to get this money? Oh, I can tell you, because you voted in favor of increasing it. It's going to come from Social Security and education. You just don't want to say it, and you don't want to own it. And after 21 years, he's suddenly saying he's now a progressive as of his August 4th town hall 2017. After 21 years of self-described moderacy, he's all of a sudden a progressive. And he's all of a sudden in favor of Medicare for All. Where were you in 2003, 4, 5, 6, 7, all the way up until this year? Where were you? Adam had a chance to represent his very progressive district. We swung in the caucuses 72% for Bernie Sanders. He had his opportunity and his golden chance to demonstrate, I'm going to vote with my district, and he's a superdelegate. He could have superdelegated for Bernie Sanders like his district wanted him to, but instead he said, and the TLDR version of it is basically, I don't have to do what the voters say, I'm not bound to that, it's more important that I do what the party wants. And he voted for Hillary Clinton. He showed that he's not actually going to stand up for progressive values. Of course it's easy for him to say he's progressive now when he's not actually going to have to hold fast to those values with a Republican-controlled House and Senate and presidency. It's easy to say he's a progressive right now because he doesn't actually have to do the work. But when he did have the chance, he did nothing. In 2008, when he had the chance to be a voice for all progressive values and we had the House, Senate, and presidency, Adam Smith said and did nothing.
Oh my God, I love this video. Before I say anything, I want to thank Adam Douglas. He's the guy from Progressives Unite who made this video and shared it with the Sarah Smith campaign, and that's how I came to know of him. But here's one thing I want to say. Recently there was, Ryan Grip did a report on how the DCCC is asking candidates to raise $250,000 before they throw their support behind them. Adam Smith has to date donated more than at least $250,000 from what I have calculated from his FEC filings. So, okay, that's why he gets a DCCC green light. But here's the thing. If the focus of the DCCC, like Jimmy said, is going to be money, big money, and how much money can you raise, then you're going to be out of touch of the school teacher, of the nurse, of the football coach. You are out of touch, Adam Smith. Bring on your army of mercenaries, because we have an army of warriors here, and warriors will be the mercenaries. Here's the clear difference between Adam Smith and Sarah Smith. Adam Smith does not believe money in politics corrupts. He told me that to my face when I went to ask him in his town hall. And Sarah Smith is not taking any corporate money. Adam Smith is a member of Council of Foreign Relations. We just discussed that before Ozzie came on. It is basically a neoliberal think tank that pushes for deregulation, was in favor of NAFTA, and wants to reduce the deficit by taking money from Social Security and Medicare. That is money you put in, money that you put in out of your paycheck every time. That's what they want to use to clear the debt created by the wars that Bush and his buddies pushed. To end the status quo, we need an antithesis. You cannot fight these problems created by money in politics by putting in another representative who takes corporate money. We need something that is a force of good, in the government, somebody who's fierce and bold and unapologetically progressive, whose policies don't change based on which legislative district she's talking to. That is my candidate. She's going to be my congresswoman. That's all I have to say. Oof.
You go, girl. Heck yeah, man. That's exactly, oh, I couldn't have said it better myself.
If that doesn't shiver Adam Smith's timbers, nothing will. God rest his soul. I just want to say thank you for my segment again, everybody. And remember, if we don't support independent media, because when you don't, this is what you get. Arr, and the Land of Oz wants to ask you, from Oz the princess herself, are you a progressive Democrat or a corporate Democrat? The Land of Oz supports whole Washington healthcare for all, because healthcare is a human right. Arr. Thank you all.
Thank you, Oz.
Thank you very much, Oz. Great report.
Thank you.
So during that, we were going to have Ryan Skolnick come in for an update on California's Medicare for All issues. He has since dropped out, so we're not going to be able to talk about that. We do have Sean Tanner, who's joining us in here. I'm not sure if he's going to be contributing much, but welcome, Sean, for joining us here on Progressive Washington. Anything you'd like to come in and say and talk about?
Wow, was that video powerful. Oh my God. Whew. Yeah, sorry, I just need to collect myself. Sorry, folks, I just need a minute. Yeah, thank you guys for having me. I can't believe the direction and the strength that this movement's getting. I've watched. I live here in the 3rd congressional district in Washington. We've got a candidate just as incredible as Sarah. And those two, Dorothy and Sarah, are going to be such an amazing team in Congress come January of next year and beyond. They're going to fight for the people instead of the corporations. They're going to do right by us instead of the corporations. And I cannot wait to spend the next 11 months, 10 months until the general and beyond, and work behind and with and alongside all of these great and amazing and wonderful progressives that we've got. Time is now, folks. The time is now. We've got to stand up. It's time. It's time to put in the work.
It's time to fight. It's time to start fighting for people and not corporations. Corporations have been waiting, and it's time that we get some people elected that don't take money from the corporations, that don't pander and become corporate shills for industry and polluting the environment and all of that. We need to end it. The corruption is killing us, literally.
I absolutely agree, Brian. I know myself and most other progressives are doing the work that we're doing because we have
shit.
Most of us have kids, you know, we have children and we've got to create a world and a society where our kids are going to have a better opportunity than we could have ever imagined for ourselves. I'm doing the work that I'm doing because of my kids, because I want my kids to have a chance of survival, to have a chance at a life, to have a chance at having just as much of a chance of being able to thrive as the kids of the corporate, you know, the CEOs and the corporate executives. They have just as much of a right and just as much of a chance and an opportunity to have that life than they do, if not more. You know, the time is now, folks. Get up off your butts, get up off your couches, get out in the streets, support your local progressive candidates. If you have the chance, donate to their campaigns. If not, doorbell, call, whatever you can do to get these people elected and to change the course of this country and the world, do it. Please, I beg you, our children beg you. The time is now.
That's the message, John. That's the message. I'd like to see everybody that was out for Bernie at all the rallies when Hillary couldn't fill up a half of a high school gymnasium. I want those people out there. We all have that conviction. We didn't lose. We were inspired. And we need to get out there and inspire everybody just like us that want to have a future that is great for our children, our brothers and sisters across the country. And we just cannot do enough this cycle. So let's get out there and fill up those auditoriums and big events for candidates like Sarah Smith and Dorothy Gasquet, Tambourine Borelli, and the rest of them. Let's get out there and put our progressive talk to the walk. Thanks so much, Sean. We appreciate that passionate plea to everybody. And it's going to be heard either today, tomorrow, and in the future. Thank you so much.
Absolutely, guys. I need to step away for a second. I'll be right back.
No problem. Thanks for joining in, and thanks for giving us that little bit there. Does anybody else have anything to say?
I think we're good.
All right. So for some reason, I'm not showing me coming up on the screen when I talk, which is a little weird.
What does show when you talk?
I am just in the background. You guys show whoever the last one was. I'm running it. Hopefully my audio is coming through. If I'm not coming through, please let me know on YouTube.
Oh, there's that YouTube. We hear you.
We've got, I'm streaming and recording and I'm doing this all on the fly. So it's working out pretty well so far. And I hope that everybody's hearing me. I'm going to try this here. Spotlight video. There we go.
Yep.
That'll work.
You. Mm-hmm.
So I had a little bit that I wanted to talk about. I had the Bernie Sanders Medicare for All event, and I wanted to discuss that. And first, I kind of wanted to get your guys' thoughts of what you were feeling when you were watching that Bernie Sanders Medicare for All.
So I was watching it in Union Bar in Hillman City. With a bunch of other progressives. We created that event on Our Revolution. So a bunch of Our Revolution people had supporters were also there. And it was a wonderful mix. I'd expected the crowd to be a lot younger than it really was. It was mostly middle-aged women. It was very, a lot of women were there. But we had a lot of fun. It energized a lot of people, and even the people who were just coming to drink in the bar who had not heard of that event, they were super excited. And it's such obvious things that Bernie points out, and it's all the questions that mainstream media asks and can really just Google it and find the answers to it. But they ask these questions on their media channels as if their answers mysteries that cannot be solved. And Bernie Sanders sort of laid it out against all of those arguments. And that's why I loved it.
Absolutely. It all feels like we know this. This isn't the first time this has been said to us. Michael Moore did a movie about healthcare.
Yeah, Sicko.
Yeah, Sicko. Yep.
Sicko. Great movie, by the way.
So we just need more people to know, and it's happening. That's the exciting part. It's happening. We're doing it. He's doing it.
Finally. That's what I'm most excited about is as a person that has is currently on, you know, state Medicare or Medicaid, excuse me. Medicaid is what I'm on. And to be able to have everybody covered would be like the ultimate goal. Like I've been in the insurance industry since 1 year old. And when I turned 18, they kicked me off of Medicare and said, go get a job and get your own insurance. And I've been trying to do that ever since. It's been spotty off and on. And I've gone to emergency rooms and had to pay $20,000 just to get one dose of my medication because I didn't have insurance and I couldn't get it. So those kinds of things would go away. You would never have to worry about that. If you get sick, you wouldn't have to worry. How am I going to pay for the doctor visit? How am I going to live paying medical bills? What have we learned, right? That most people that are thrown out on the streets in poverty, it's because they can't pay their medical bills that they're in poverty in the first place. So this absurdity that we have to treat healthcare as a profit-driven business is complete and utter disgracefully implemented in our country, that just makes us look so damn greedy, and we're not. The people that I associate with, the people that I know, the true America that I am trying to be a part of, we're not like that. That's not who we are. That does not represent us. And what Bernie's saying, that's what we need. That's what needs to happen.
Yep. And I might add to Brian's point, like they'll be on Medicare, you're until 16 now, get off, go get a job. As long as you are making somebody rich in America, you'll get some crumbs out of that. As if working class did not help create the wealth that currently exists. So all the medical advancements, majority of the immunizations were done by the military, discovered by the military. We pay for the military. It's our tax dollars that paid for most of the medical research in American history. Now they tell us that we cannot reap the rewards of it unless we are making them even richer. Healthcare is a human right because we have now reached at a point where there is enough. If somebody gets healthcare for free, you're not taking it away from anybody. There's no scarcity. They have created this artificial scarcity and two-tier justice system, two-tier education system, two-tier healthcare system. If you're rich, you get the best of everything. If you're poor,
there have been studies done all over. I'm in Tacoma Pierce County, and the local hospitals or public assistance people from each agency came together. And they started looking at what was costing the most. And you know what they found? They found there were three people in Tacoma whose repeated emergency needs, and one in particular out of the three, were jacking the budget up. It was like 2/3 of the cost of the budget for this program. And so they ended up helping these three people live lives that reduced their emergency response needs. So a little extra time, a little public support, and we reduced public cost. We eliminated two-thirds of the budget, or well, two-thirds of the use of that budget, and opened it up for expanding to help more people. And that's the kind, I wish I could quote locations or sources, but I've seen articles where they've done citywide studies and they see pockets of poverty or food desert or what different impacts in different neighborhoods, and what they can do. And it often means nurses visiting in home weekly to monthly to help. That often helps with new and young mothers. There are similar programs for different segments of our population. And a little proactive work saves a lot of money on the back end of things.
And we create
jobs. It's logic.
We create jobs. You need these nurses. If you have public childcare, you need those childcare providers. These are good paying government job with benefits and hopefully pensions. We don't talk about that anymore. I am from India and I had a pension account, and in my one and a half year of work there, I had enough money for 4 or 5 months of rent, actually more than that, almost 10 months of rent. And that was just 1.5 years. I had so much more working life ahead of me. That is security. We had that in America. The labor movement fought for that. And now with corporate Democrats have taken that away from us. Bill Clinton shoved the labor unions out of the Democratic Party. And that has led to the decline of the moral of the society in America.
That's right. Thank you, Supreet.
Can I speak to Brian's question real quick? Do you mind? I just want to make a point. On the town hall, Brian, one of the starkest realities that was pointed out in that town hall was last year, 36,000 people died because they didn't have adequate insurance. And the corporate-owned Democrat apologists are trying to say they want to shore up the ACA, the for-profit health insurance program that doesn't even cover 28 million people in this country. That to me is shameful. We need to have a single payer Medicare for all system like a whole Washington they're trying to put through, or we're going to have more and more people die. Next year, it might be 72,000. Is that going to wake up everybody? That healthcare town hall was wonderful. And I would like to see that replayed over and over again until it gets through to some of the knuckleheads who are saying, oh, we got to shore up the ACA. Programs like CHIP and the ACA are put in as quarter measures to thwart single-payer, not-for-profit health care for this country. That's all they are, and that's the rhetoric, I'll say propaganda, that's coming from the corporate-owned Democrats. We need to vote in progressives who represent the people, the baker, the machinist, the transportation, the school teacher. Like Supreet said, we have no representation. The representation of the corporate Democratic Party is for the donor class and the donor class only. Thanks, guys.
Yes, Thank you, also, if Bernie's going to run, he needs all the support. He needs Bernie-crats at every level inside the government, no matter which party you're running from. Run for PCOs. Run for help candidates that maybe volunteer on their campaign, get signatures for initiatives, and just keep bothering the Democratic Party in whatever way you can. And we will win.
Oh, speaking of bothering the Democrat, we have in CD 8, right now that's filled by Reichert. I don't know why I can't think of his first name, but anyway, Reichert is in there and he is retiring this year or maybe. And then Dino Rossi is running to replace him on the Republican ticket. But we have a ridiculous amount of people running. Well, no, it's an inspiring amount of people. Like, yay, people go run for office. But there's, I don't know, six to eight people in the race. Some have dropped out already. And there are community town halls or forums coming up in CD8, which is, it straddles the Cascade Mountains, includes Issaquah, and then also North Bend, I believe. There's a good map on the Washington, I'm sorry?
To the north till Samamis.
And north in the mountains?
The northern part of District 8, the northern part of District 8 goes all the way till Sammamish in the north. And then in the south, I think it wraps right under, like into Tacoma, it wraps right under District 9, but I don't know which towns are there in the south. So.
Yeah, I think it's it goes into Federal Way. I'm not sure if it reaches all the way to Tacoma, but it is certainly in Pierce County and near us. And it's not far from the Port of Tacoma. And I also am curious to look at a detailed map to see if it includes any of the Puyallup Reservation, because then that really ties District 8 into the LNG issue. I say all the local CDs should have something to say about the LNG at the Port of Tacoma. But so there are town halls coming. There's one in Graham on the 31st, I believe. One in Auburn. I shouldn't be guessing, but my computer runs slow, so I'm having a hard time hopping through stuff. Issaquah on February 10th, Saturday morning. I'm sorry, that's organizing. So, there is an Issaquah one and an Ellensburg one, I believe, February 24th-ish. It's further out in the month of February. So we need to make sure that those events get streamed, live streamed. And we also need to make sure that people attend who want to demand policy, because out of those people, we need to define exactly how many people are taking corporate money and support the one or ones that are not taking corporate money. And I don't want to make statements that I haven't confirmed. We know that there is at least one person running who is not taking corporate money. So now we have to check on the rest of them and discuss policy. So we need people to go to these meetings, ask where your financials are where your financial support is coming from, and what their policy stances are. And we have to have that live streamed. And we need to make sure that the Democratic Party who's hosting these forums understand who the populace will be voting for. We will be voting for people with good policy. So we have to come to these events, and we'll get those also linked up to, where all the links go.
Basically stack the audience with progressive supporters so the Democratic Party gets a message.
Yes.
I think we're ready to
keep the Medicare. We wanted to keep the Medicare for All train going. I believe we have Ryan Skolnick in here, who's going to give us some updates on what's going on in California. And he's also been working with Whole Washington. So go ahead and unmute yourself and welcome in Ryan.
Ryan is muted, I think.
It's not letting me unmute him.
Is he on a phone?
I believe so, yeah. He was having some difficulty joining in. There we go. He's muted again.
Ryan, you had it. There we go.
Okay.
There you go. Yes, we hear you. Thanks for joining.
All right. Thanks for having me, everyone.
Thanks.
I'm like was said, I'm a volunteer with the Healthy California campaign, and also helped with drafting of the Whole Washington initiative. I'll be for just a short time. I really wanted to talk about the California effort because a lot of interesting stuff happened there. So for some background, it passed the state Senate and went to the assembly. And our assembly speaker, Anthony Rendon, has shelved the bill. And what that means is well, basically how our assembly works is the rules committee takes up bills and decides where to send them for amendment and stuff. He chairs rules and he's refused to assign the bill for to committee, which means it's functionally just there in limbo, can't be amended or anything. And throughout this whole time, he's been making up lie after lie about not just single payer, but the bill specifically, trying to justify his behavior. So since we're powerless to do anything about it, we've basically just been putting a ton of pressure on, and it's starting to bear some fruit. Speaker Rendon, to try and seem like he's actually doing something, convened what he calls the Assembly Select Committee on Healthcare, which is just this sham thing where he brings a bunch of anti-single-payer people in to talk about how complicated healthcare is without actually doing anything. We've put so much pressure on that committee that now for the next meeting, the 7th, they promised they would discuss SB 562, which is our single-payer bill, finally. So we're organizing people to flood that room and to make sure that they hear that their excuses for shelving the bill aren't legitimate. We know better, and we need them to take action, because in the state of California, 5 people die every day from lack of adequate health care, and we need to do something about it.
Ryan, I'm originally from California. I grew up in the San Joaquin Valley in Stockton. My mom still lives in the area. She lives in Manteca. I could probably fairly easily mobilize a good amount of people to get there. I'm sorry, I can't talk right now. To get in there to the Capitol and help you guys out.
That'd be awesome. The meeting is February 7th. I believe the select committee starts at 10 a.m. So okay. the more the merrier.
Great. So I have, some inroads with some activists in the Sacramento area. I will absolutely reach out and make sure that they're there on the 7th.
That'd be great. What's basically happening now is they're basically pretending as if the bill is unworkable by saying things like, oh, well, what are you going to do about the federal government? Donald Trump won't allow you to do single payer, as if Donald Trump can just decide that California doesn't have that ability. Our ability to implement that kind of system is already in law. They're pretending that there's no funding source, even though we proposed one from the University of Massachusetts, a really good one. The 2.3% gross receipts tax and a 2.3% sales tax both have exemptions, so they're more progressive. They're basically ignoring the study and pretending that it doesn't exist, and saying, well, why didn't you think of funding? The reality is, the funding study was completed after the bill had already gone through Senate appropriations, so we weren't able to add it then. So we met with the speaker's office after the bill passed the Senate, and they said, don't worry about that. Just focus on policy. We'll deal with funding in the appropriations committee in the assembly. And then, of course, Rendon shelved the bill, which shows that he's just a complete liar.
Well, thank you for those updates. I'm looking forward to universal healthcare as we come state by state, and I have family in California. They're low income and on state aid, and my grandparents would always speak so highly about the quality of care in California, and then they'd turn around and ask her why she didn't get married, and she's got a permanently disabled child. So and that's what they were so happy about, was their assistance with her. And but they were always so frustrated that my cousin didn't get married. And but the reality was that if she got married, then she wouldn't have any medical care because the state would stop helping.
Yeah, it's an absurd bureaucratic system, as all multi-payer systems are, and it's not necessary. The effort in Washington is just getting kicked off. They're paying because Washington has an incredibly regressive tax system. The initiative is funded on income and a capital gains tax mostly. So since California's tax code is more progressive, it was harder to make it to add those kind of things when they're already pretty high. But the whole Washington initiative is going up soon. And yeah, we're just got to keep the fight going because this is a life or death issue for so many people, like you said.
Well, thank you for all your work. Is there anything else, any contact information?
If you go on Facebook, you can find Whole Washington there. Definitely follow their page. They have a Whole Washington Volunteers page and they'll have action items for you to help advance the cause. Definitely check those pages out. Overall, I think that the drafting committee did an excellent job. Like I said, I was only with them a short time, but I was very happy to work with people who are so diligent, hardworking, and so committed to fixing the broken healthcare system. And if we have to do it state by state, we'll have to do it state by state. It's what it takes.
Indeed.
Thank you so much, Ryan, for joining in and letting us know everything that's going on. Is there anything else that you would like to talk about?
I think the main thing is just continue to keep pressure on. Speaker Rendon in California has taken over $700,000 from the insurance companies. The chair of his select committee has also taken a ton of money, Jim Wood. So we have a lot of powerful interests working against us. And Rendon is starting to crack a little bit. He did a meet and greet for people in his district, and he fled after 15 minutes because there was so much outrage about what he's been doing with 562. And it's been like 3/4 of a year since he shelved it. He expected it to die down and people not care anymore, but he can't go anywhere without being pressured for what he's doing. So it's important. We can't allow them to get away with that kind of thing. I'm sure that there's going to be similar barriers that are going to come up in Washington as well, because there are a lot of powerful interests here, but we got to keep fighting. And I guess that's the last thing I have to say.
Awesome. Thank you so much.
Thanks for having me.
You're very welcome. Come on anytime you want, man. All right, so there was some other things that needed to get brought up before we get to a close. We've been running a little over an hour now. So there was some events that I wanted to talk about. I don't have slides to bring them up, but there's a few events in the state. Some are coming up very soon. We have first some democracy building events, Fixing Democracy, Civic Skillshare. It's supposed to be a very interesting and in-depth type of networking event. So if you want to know how to get the skills that we're going to need to fight all of these interests that are obviously up against us and trying to prevent us from succeeding, then these type of events are going to be very important. Not only for right now, but for the future, right? We're also planning for 2020, and we're just getting started with 2018. So the more you know, the better. If you can get to these events, I would highly encourage it, because the people that are not wanting us to succeed are already strapped with the knowledge that they need to keep the status quo. It is our job to arm ourselves with knowledge to be able to combat them. And to be able to know your civics is one of the biggest things that you can do, because if you can play the game, then you can be the game. So I encourage everybody, please check out the events that we have, that we post up, that we share, because we're not just sharing them for fun, right? These are important things that we all need to kind of take part in if we really want to take back our democracy, because we don't have a democracy right now. And these are the ways that we can get the tools available to us to be able to pursue that. This event here for 350 is going to be located in Seattle. It's mostly about climate justice, reading through it. Their main topics are going to be how we the people became marginalized by our government, how artificial persons gained power over the people, how we can use our rights to defend what we love, tools to engage the system change, and finally, how we can overrule the courts. So with these weapons at our disposal, if we can learn how to do all of this, we will better be prepared to implement all of the things that we need to take our democracy back from the oligarchs. It's as simple as that. So I don't think that we have any questions. Did anybody else want to comment about the events that are coming up?
Well, I would like to say that there is a Facebook group now, it's a Facebook page. I'm not hip to the language still, and I'm cool, I promise. But there's a Facebook page called Progressive Washington Media. We're trying to get every event we see posted that is even remotely progressive based on policy that we want to influence with progressive policy, we put it there. So Progressive Washington Media, and we are looking for dedicated Facebook warriors who live in Eastern Washington who would like to maybe become moderators on the page so that they can drop events in from Eastern Washington. You know, there's Tri-Cities and Spokane and Pullman and Tenasket. Once in a while, there's something happening there. OMAC. We know OMAC had a woman's march, and there were about 400 people there. So they're everywhere in Washington that there are people, someone will want to talk about policy, and we need to make that happen. So we need people from those areas to help us promote those events. And then we also need people in those areas to create events. So if there isn't anything happening in your county or LD that is in line with you, do something that's in line with you. If you want to work on healthcare, contact Whole Washington. If you want to work on democracy, contact Fix Democracy First or Represent Us. If you want to work on a multi-pronged approach, you can join any of the parties or associations like Dems and, I mean, shoot, there are Republicans who are running on progressive policy. There are the Green Party. If there isn't one in your area, start one. I know there's one, at least one in Eastern Washington. DSA, Democratic Socialists of America. There are groups in Eastern Washington, but if there's not one in your specific area, start one. So find your passion, start a group or join a group on your passion. And then you build coalition meetings where you reach out to the other groups in your area and you say, let's work on the things, let's work together on the things we agree about. And then you elect people who represent those shared ideals. And when we talk policy, we win people over who would normally vote for a Republican, but they understand that we all need healthcare and education. And most progressives that I know can agree with most Republicans on gun legislation in that we protect the Second Amendment, but there are laws that we all agree that can be passed about like universal background checks. So policy is the winning theme. When you talk policy, you win votes. So get out there and talk to your neighbors about policy and take the values out, the value, words of like values, it's kind of nebulous, but when we talk policy, there's clarity. So create events and go to events and share it with us so that we can share it with you all again.
Right. So it's be the change, right? So, I mean, if I love that she said, find something that you're passionate about, right? So let me tell you what I'm passionate about. Climate change, Medicare for all, and why do I always forget that third one? I always forget that third one. But I've got my top three that I try to concentrate on. Not only that, I have others, you know, that I'm passionate about that I don't need to push too hard because I've got my top three. So it really matters of what drives you, because ultimately that's what's going to fuel your desire for change, right? If there's something that you care about, do it. You know, quit waiting for somebody else to step up, quit waiting for somebody else to start an event, quit waiting for somebody else to go to these meetings and tell these corporate shills that we have in our government that they're doing a horrible job. Don't let somebody else say that for you. You need to be the change, and you need to say it to get the message across. That's the only way that anybody's going to listen. So, which actually leads into the next event that I wanted to talk about, which is to prevent burnout, right? So there's so many activists and people doing this work that it does get overwhelming, right? We're in the trenches. We know exactly what people are going through, and it's hard. It is extremely hard to consistently be on the front line and fight these battles of the minds that with people that have so much money and so much time to be able to just throw all this stuff at us. It's ridiculous. So we got to not forget to take some time for us, right? To be able to self-reflect, be able to heal, and be able to stay on consistently come back and be on the front lines to do the work that needs to be done. There's another event coming up for, oh geez, I lost my spot. It's a 2-hour workshop. We'll present movement and reflection as a self-care toolkit to help individuals release stress and negative emotions relating to current actions, environmental degradation, and climate change. This event will be a healing space facilitated by Felicia Tripp and Jasmine Ramgantra. I apologize if I messed that name up. And this is for 350 Seattle. I'll hopefully be able to get the links into description after this goes live, and we'll get this into individual segments for you guys too. It's located 1919 East Prospect Street in Seattle. And I just really, really want to encourage you all to check it out and get involved, because we all need help and we all can't do this alone, right? We have to stand together and we have to be the change. So with that, I'll let you guys finish up with anything that you need, and I will shut my app. Thank you.
Well, I would say, in addition to that, I would love to see more meditation events for progressive peace. And I've been also toying with the idea that, and it's going in the starter kit that we're developing, that you should have a progressive party. Like, once you start going to meetings and doing direct actions and door knocking and having coalition meetings, you should do a fundraiser at a local, you can choose the best location for your group, but I'm guessing that it would involve alcohol probably, and maybe a DJ or band. and you know, just go jump around a little bit, and I know that there is a bar near me that is willing to host. Like, you go in, you get the DJ, and 10% of the bar goes to your event. So but it's not a time for preaching, it's a time for partying. So do have fun with our efforts. It's important, but we can't burn out. Burn bright, not out.
Very well said. I like that saying.
Thank you.
All right, so I think that is it. Did anybody else care to add anything before we head out?
What's the song today? And I want to thank everybody that came in and was on the panel.
Yes.
I don't think that we really had a song.
Oh, we can pick one right now.
Let's figure one out. What do we want to hear?
I thought we picked Tracy Chapman.
Yay,
Revolution. Oh, that's right. We did.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. And okay. Thank you,
Rhonda.
I'm glad you made it into the show, Rhonda.
Well, I didn't really. I've been listening in while I was driving because I can't, you know, participate fully while I'm driving. So to be legal and safe.
Yes.
I've been listening in.
I saw you lurking. It was wonderful.
I was lurking.
So, yeah, Tracy Chapman. Oh, she's so good.
I missed the beginning of the show, so I can't wait to rewatch it. And just listening in, you guys are just amazing.
Thank you, Rhonda.
Well, you're us guys, Rhonda. You're us guys too. So, and Rhonda, I wish you would have been here because I wanted her to play Crazy Train for the song, but they outvoted me and went with Tracy Chapman. I don't understand why.
Right? I don't understand it either, Ross.
All right, guys. So thank you, everybody, for tuning in. We're going to head out with Tracy Chapman talking about a revolution. Thank you very much.
Bye, everybody.
About a revolution sounds like a whisper. Don't you know? Talking about a revolution sounds like a whisper. While they're standing in the welfare lines, crying at the doorsteps of those armies of salvation, wasting time in the unemployment lines, sitting around waiting for a promotion. Don't you know? Talking about a revolution sounds whisper. Poor people gonna rise up, get their share. Poor people gonna rise up, take what's theirs. Don't you know you better run, 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 run. Oh, I said you better run, 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 run. Cause finally the tables are starting. Talking about a revolution. Yes, finally the tables are starting to turn. Talking about a revolution. Oh, oh, no. Talking about a revolution. Oh, oh, while they're standing in the welfare lines, crying at the doorsteps of those armies of salvation, wasting time unemployment lines, sitting around waiting for a promotion. Don't you know? Talking about a revolution sounds like a whisper. And finally the tables are starting to turn. Talking about a revolution. Yes, finally the tables are starting. Talking about a revolution, oh, oh, no. Talking about a revolution, oh, oh, no. Talking about a revolution, oh, oh, no.
Yeah, can somebody stop it? I'm locked up.